In contents, we will read blood supply of long bones, then osteomyelitis, special form of osteomyelitis, and some other non-pyogenic bone infections like TB, skeletal, syphilis, fungal osteomyelitis. So, blood supply of the long bone is majorly by the nutrient artery, which is the major source of blood supply. Second is periosteal vessels, and third is metaphyseal and epiphyseal vessels. So this is the nutrient artery which enters bone, and thereafter it supplies by giving its branches. So this is the normal vascular supply in a tubular bone in child, infant and adult. We'll deal with adult first. The growth plate is no longer present in the adult one, so blood supply to the metaphyses and at the distal end of the bone are continuous. While in case of infant, it is supplied in both in the growth plate and distal epiphyses part, and in case of child, it only major blood supply is present over the metaphyses. That's why osteomyelitis is common in this region in child age group in metaphyseal part. Osteomyelitis is, we know this is the infection of bone and bone marrow, and the osteomyelitis, osteon means bone and the myelo means marrow, with itis means inflammation, inflammation of bone and marrow both. Predisposing factors are decreased immunity of the body. So what are the conditions? Diabetes, sickle cell disease, AIDS, IV drug abuse, alcoholism, chronic steroid use, immunosuppression and chronic joint disease. These are the organisms responsible for the osteomyelitis. Most common is the Staph aureus, E. coli, Pseudomonas, Klebsiella. In PPG exams, NEET exams, various questions you will see over the bacterial causes of osteomyelitis. So most common is Staph aureus. E. coli is most common in IV drug users and in GIT infections. Then in sickle cell, again Salmonella species is the most common. These two questions are oftenly asked. One, Staph aureus most common. Second, in sickle cell, which one is most common? Salmonella. Then classification on the basis of duration. 2 weeks from onset of symptoms to, up to 2 weeks, it is acute. From 2 weeks to 2 months, subacute, and more than 2 months means more than 8 weeks, it is chronic. Coming to the spread of infection, most common source of infection is the hematogenous. Again, PPG question. Then contagious spread, suppose koi kaata gad gaya and thereafter direct bone tak reach ho gaya wo, that is contagious spread. Direct implantation of infection. So locations are lower femur part, upper tibia part, means around the knee joint. In vertebrae, lumbar part is most common, then thoracic, then cervical. So the location of osteomyelitis within a bone varies with age. In neonates, as I told you, metaphyses and or epiphyses. In children, mainly metaphyses, because this is infection and infections can grow only at that site where the blood supply is present. In adult, epiphyses and the subcontinental regions. Clinical feature, you know, as you have seen cases of osteomyelitis in orthopedics department. Patient present with fever, pain and swelling, local sign of inflammation, and extensive loss of limb function because of severe pain. This is the pathophysiology. Once there is implantation of pathogen in medullary tissue, inflammation occurs. Thereafter, inflammation leads to local ischemic changes over the bone, leading to necrosis. Then abscess formation, abscess burst, lead to the because of intramedullary pressure, and thereafter further process begins. What are the further process? Formation of sequestra. Sequestra is the dead bone, and then once dead bone is formed, it leads to the chronic osteomyelitis. So these are the pictorial diagram showing you the inflammatory process. Here you can see the cortical thickening. Black cortical thickening is there. This is the abscess which burst out. So what is sequestrum? This is the dead bone in situ. And what is involucrum? It is the new bone formation. So, and what is cloaca? Cloaca is the defect which gives rise to the continuous discharge. So cloaca, involucrum, these are the features of chronic osteomyelitis. The radiographic feature. What is the earliest radiographic sign of bone infections? Soft tissue swelling, and loss or blurring of normal fat planes. First of all, it involves the soft tissue, doesn't involve the bone. This is the radiographic sign. And it encountered within 24 to 48 hours of infection. So again, one 3PG question. At what period of time you will diagnose radiologically osteomyelitis? So it is 24 to 48 hours of infection. In which modality? X-ray. Second, third question. What are the signs, earliest radiographic signs of bone infection, soft tissue swelling, and loss or blurring of normal fat planes? Then second questions arise, in which you will see in pre-PG exam, that what is the earliest modality, or what is the which modality we can use for the earliest diagnosis of the osteomyelitis? Answer is CT, MR, USG, X-ray. Answer is
MRI.
So earliest modality is the MRI for the diagnosis of osteomyelitis. Although earliest radiographic sign on X-ray are these, but earliest modality is the MRI. So early finding may be subtle and changes may not be obvious until 5 to 7 days in children and 10 to 14 days in adults. These are the early bone changes. Let's see over the X-ray, then you can understand what is the meaning of this all terms. Focal bony lysis or cortical loss, periosteal reaction, thickening, endosteal scalloping, loss of trabecular architecture, knee bone apposition, regional osteopenia, eventual peripheral sclerosis. So this is your pictorial diagram of the bone. You can see this is the metaphyseal part, epiphyseal, and this is the diaphyseal part. In diaphysis, you can see the white medullary cavity. So first, there is the bone abscess form. This is the periosteum. These are the involucrum, which are the new bone formation. This is the subperiosteal pus formation. So destruction of adjacent cortex. Now, which one is formed early? First, abscess is formed. Second thing, sequestrum, which is dead bone. Here it is written wrong. Sequestrum pehle banta hai, then involucrum means the new bone formation. It occur later. And once the abscess form, it give rise to pressure and leading to the cloaca formation, periosteal elevation. Thereafter, the discharge will occur, and due to continuous discharge as a part of reparative process or constructive process, involucrum will form thereafter. So sequestrum is a dense, and it does not participate in the normal bone mineral metabolism because of loss of its vascular supply. So you can see the acute osteomyelitis, the first X-ray. This is the first X-ray. Then 2 days after the symptoms, it began in normal metaphyseal mottling. Mottling means the loss of bone formation is there. There is no bone. This is metaphyseal mottling. You can see in the upper part of tibia. So this is the first X-ray. And what are the earliest signs of osteomyelitis? As we seen, soft tissue swelling and loss of blurring of normal fat planes. So here you can see we can't appreciate here. Soft tissue swelling appreciation nahi ho raha hai. Isliye X-ray is not the modality of choice for investigation of osteomyelitis. MRI is the modality of choice. Then after 14 days later, you can see the excessive periosteal reaction is there. This is the typical osteomyelitic bone. You can see the cloaca. You can see the involucrum, new bone formation is there, and you can see the sequestrum, the dead bone present inside the medullary cavity. This is the medullary cavity, this is the cortex periosteum. Ultrasound is not so much reliable, only it can detect the bone irregularity, it can detect the abscess. Now this is the CT image, axial image of your tibia and fibula. So what you can see? We can see the medullary cavity is totally obliterated by this white structure. And what is this? Sequestrum. Coming to the MRI, it is the most sensitive and specific. Again, I repeat, it is most sensitive and specific for osteomyelitis. On T1, T2, this you will not catch up at this time. Now see the finding. This is MRI image. How beautiful it is seen. This is the muscle. Outer muscle. Here you can see the axial image of MRI. This is the bone. This is the outer muscle. So can you see this not the light black inside the dark white? So this is light back is actually the abscess, intramuscular abscess formation. These are the intramuscular abscess formation. And this appreciate as the soft tissue swelling. Can you see the soft tissue swelling? A bulging white part. This is the soft tissue swelling. This is on the X-ray. So ye X-ray koi bhi normal bhi report kar sakta hai. That's why the investigation of choice is MRI. In MRI you will see, oh, there is a lot of abscess, intramuscular abscess, and intramedullary abscess is also seen, and the cortical thickening is there. What you can see, this is the CT image again, and this is the ultrasound image. You can see this ultrasound, bone irregularity is there, and ye jo box dikh raha hai, ye color ka box hai, color jab hum dalte ultrasound mein, this white are the color vascularity, so there is raised vascularity. This is the power Doppler highlights hyperemia around the periosteum. Coming to the subacute osteomyelitis. Subacute osteomyelitis who suffered from bone infection for several days with start to exhibit bone reaction and destruction. So lots of periosteal reaction you will see in the subacute osteomyelitis. There is some periosteal fluid and edema is there, and this is the most MRI again is the most sensitive technique for detection of subacute osteomyelitis. Coming to the chronic osteomyelitis. In chronic, the reason behind it is the delayed or the inadequate treatment, and the cloaca will form and this persistent discharge will be seen in case of chronic osteomyelitis. In chronic osteomyelitis, thickened and irregular bone and adjacent joint stiffness is there, and chronic discharging sinus. This discharging sinus word is important for the chronic osteomyelitis. Treatment and prognosis is not a part of radiology. We will see in orthopedics. Complications, yes, you have to detect complication on radiology, in radiology. So sinus tract formation with occasional superimposed squamous cell carcinoma. This is the late multifocal three PG question. Okay.
Tibia,
femur.
Tibia.
Sorry.
Tibia.
Tibia. Yes. Good. Second most common site of sclerosing osteomyelitis of Guéret. Jaw, humerus, clavicle, and sternum. Sorry. What will be the right answer out of these four options? Jaw, clavicle, sternum, humerus.
Sir, jaw.
Jaw. Very good. So Brody's abscess location in the metaphysis again, particularly distal or proximal tibial metaphysis. Okay. So this is a localized form of subacute osteomyelitis. Third pre-PG question, all these are kind of Brody's and sclerosing osteomyelitis of Guéret is the subacute type of osteomyelitis. It is not acute, it is not chronic, it is subacute. So this is the subacute form of osteomyelitis. How it looks like? This is Brody's abscess. It just look like your a tumor, but this is a abscess. So what is the differential diagnosis of Brody's abscess? Osteoid osteoma. Osteoid osteoma ke jaise dikh raha hai isliye osteoid osteoma, but it is Brody's abscess. This is the again localized subacute osteomyelitis. This is sclerosing osteomyelitis of Guéret. Predilection for the involvement of mandible. And the shaft of long bones. Coming to the non-pyogenic bone infection, tubercular osteomyelitis, fungal and skeletal syphilis. See, as a doctor, as a radiologist or orthopedician, only workup is, you have to only diagnose what osteomyelitis. You don't diagnose that it is TB, fungal, skeletal, pyogenic, non-pyogenic. It is the workup of pathologist people. So once you diagnose this, take a biopsy, take a sample of that bone biopsy, send it to the histopath department and confirm what it is. Okay. So again, TB osteomyelitis, hematogenous, it is typically slow growing. It is again involved metaphysis. Same features are there. Don't try to use your mind, don't try to invest your mind on differentiating the part of osteomyelitis. It is worthless. This is again the part of osteomyelitis, tuberculosis of the femur, large metaphyseal focus. This is dactylitis. What is dactylitis? Inflammation of the metacarpal bone. So a term is used is spina ventosa. Spina ventosa is not used for spine. It is used for your metacarpal bone. And let's read it. Oblique film of hand shows expansive fusiform lesion of first and fifth metacarpal associated with soft tissue swelling. No evidence of periosteal reaction. So this diaphyseal enlargement is known as spina ventosa. Coming to fungal osteomyelitis, these are the fungus, coccidioidomycosis, blastomycosis, cryptococcosis, nocardiosis. Again, they will form abscess and a draining sinus. These are the cryptococcosis of bone. Very difficult to identify the organism on X-ray. This is not possible on X-ray. We'll read this skeletal for today. Thank you. Slide in the middle.